praising God. Come on, go ahead. Give him praise. Give him praise. Shirabarado shakabahaya radabosh. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Grace to his name, Almighty. Somebody just wave those hands to Jesus. Just give him praise. 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 Somebody's not worshiping. Just give him praise. Give him praise. He's an awesome God. He's a glorious God. Give you all glory and our adoration. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. What an awesome worship. You're not happy? Huh. Praise God. Do you actually want us to just share the benediction and we go? No, if you want it. I need rest. Amen. Rest is so important that if you don't give your body rest, you will rest in peace. May you be seated in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I love every one of you and I miss you all so, so much. Amen. Where the Spirit, where the Spirit of the Lord is, the Bible says there is fullness of joy. And his right hand side, for there are pleasures forevermore. Oh Lord, I give you praise for your name is worthy to be praised. I'm so excited in my spirit because Mercy said no. Even when I couldn't go through, I couldn't carry on, at the verge of giving up, Mercy said no. And let me tell you, God is still in the business of lifting your head up, setting you up for success. Don't bother yourself about what you're seeing around you, for they are meant to come. Amen. The Bible said in the book of Matthew 24, Jesus was speaking about the times that we are in today. Everything you see today, everything you're experiencing today, are written in the scriptures. That's why the Bible says we should not be afraid of the terror by night. Don't be moved when the whole pestilence come up against you. Don't be moved when everything seems to be against you. But you see, there is this one strength that I draw from, and that is to say that when the world is against you and you have God by your side, for one with God is what? A majority. I want to say one more time, I'm glad to rejoin with you all, and we're just going to keep doing what God has called us to do. Amen. Hallelujah. Just bow your heads, Holy Spirit. I ask that you take absolute control. Fill this place, Lord, with your grace and power. Fill this place with your might and glory. Fill the heart of someone here, O Lord. Grant them, O Lord, divinity, that the mysteries behind whatever it is that they're going through be unveiled. Your name alone be glorified. Your name alone be exalted. Be thou praised in the highest. In the name of Jesus. That amen is not born again. That amen is still trying to survive. Hallelujah. I want to welcome you this morning to the Dunamis Palace, where we believe that no matter how punctured and ruptured the life is, it can be sutured by God. And we believe in this ministry that the Word of God is the greatest of all. Nothing supersedes the Word of God. For God has highly exalted His name, Jesus Christ. That at the mention of that name, Jesus, He said, every knee shall bow in heaven, on earth, and He said, beneath the earth. So therefore, we glorify the name of the Lord in this ministry, and we believe God that no matter what it is, whatever that has been chasing you, just keep running. Keep running. But when you get in here, you know that it is done. Praise God. Hallelujah. I want to really thank God for the Holy Spirit that God has released upon us to guide us. The Bible says, for He will teach you all things and bring things to your remembrance. Thank God for all that the Lord has done. You are ready for the word this morning? You have your Bibles with you? Lift that Bible up and say after me, say, this is the word of God. Say, this is my Bible. For it is the word of God. It is the infallible proof that God is real. It is the love letter from God to me to guide my heart, keep me safe, direct my path. For everything that is written in this word is a compass to direct me in the way I should go. I believe in the word of God. So therefore, I confess it as the greatest and the most powerful letter written from God to man. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Jam those hands together to the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. This morning, as you have your writing materials up, I believe that we have child dedication this morning. And we're going to be out here by tomorrow evening. So bear with me. I will try my best to end up by tomorrow 4 o'clock in the evening. Believers, we have left our home today to be here. Not in the house of God, but to fellowship together. You know, sometimes we say, this is the house of God. But literally, the house of God is your body. Amen. You are a carrier of divinity. And I want you to pay close attention this morning to what the Lord has for us. I'm going to be speaking on the topic I've captioned, dealing with the storm of life. There are storms. You can't deny it. Even when you try to hide your storm, somehow the storm has a way not to hide you. Praise God. There is no hurricane that go through a city that the city won't know that hurricane passed through. And you see, God has so built us up as children that in His name, as we hide ourselves in Him, breaking off from the storms of this life, He has made us to understand that there is nothing that comes to us that comes without Him being aware of it. As our faces are different, So is it also the storms in our lives are different. Many of us are having to deal with a whole lot. Many of us are having to deal with certain things last night. And today you are out this morning. Some of us got up this morning and asked ourselves, what next? Like, devil, give your best shot. What next? Am I communicating with somebody? Sometimes life will pull you away and keep you in a place and box you up. And the next thing you are asking is, what next? Let's see something in the book of John, John 16, verse 33. What did the scripture say? John 16, verse number 33. I want you to know that the storm in your life is part of the process God has for you. In one of my messages, I said to Ross, I said, do not be in a haste to jump out of your trial times. Because what makes you who you are is based on the trial you've come through. Based on the challenges you've come to experience. Based on the things you have seen in life. What makes a general is not his education. What makes a general is the scar that the general has gone through. Am I communicating with somebody? That's why it is dangerous to make a military officer, a general, increase them when they have no experience. Praise God. Because what makes you a general is the pains and the challenges and the storms of life that you've been able to go through and overcome. Hallelujah. In the book of John 16, verse 33, it says, these things I have spoken unto you. Praise God. Is the letter written in writing, in red in your Bible? Yes, sir. Good. So Jesus was speaking. He said, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have what? Peace. Get this straight. In Jesus, you will have peace. Now he says, part B of it, he said, in the world, ye shall have what? Tribulation. But he gave us some kind of assurance. He said, but be of what? Bad cheers. Come on, somebody talk to me. But be of what? But be of what? He said, for I have what? Overcome the world. Be of good cheer. For I, the Lord, I have overcome the world. So the storms that you are passing through today is not something new to God. It is what actually God has overcome on your behalf. It could be addiction. It could be anything at all. It could be challenges of life. But Jesus said, in me, you will have peace. So the peace that many go around looking for is actually in Christ. For the Bible says, for he is the Prince of Peace. I've come to you with a word today to charge you up. That it doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter the difficulties you find yourself in life. Jesus is the answer. He is the password you need to overcome the storm. And the question you will ask today and say, but Pastor, how do I? Every time I try, the storm is still there. Let me tell you. As a believer, you are not an ordinary bird. There are certain animals that God uses when he wants to talk to us as believers, as his children. One of it is the lamb, praise God, the sheep. One of it also is the eagle. One of it also is the lion. If you take into consideration the characteristics of these animals, a sheep understands what leadership is. The eagle is not afraid of the storm. You can be a believer, but you can decide that I am not just going to be a regular believer. I will decide to be an eagle believer that is not afraid of the storm, but uses the storm to outweigh and to overcome whatsoever challenges that is in front of them. Amen. Hallelujah. When an eagle sees the storm, they rejoice into the storm. It is a sad thing that today some believers, when they go through certain challenges, and the next day they say, God, why have you forsaken me? That prayer is good, but it's not for you always. Praise God. Before Jesus cried out and said, Father, why have you forsaken me? It is an agreement between the Father and the Son. But he felt our pains, not just his pain. The Bible said the chastisement of our peace was upon him. Everything that has to do with pains upon every one of us was on Christ. So the burden he had to pass through was not a personal burden, but the burden of the whole world. God will never forsake you. No matter what you're going through, he will never forsake you. No matter how the challenges has come to be, he will never forsake you. God is able, more than able, to bring you through the circumstances. I was talking to somebody and he said, Pastor, you don't understand what I'm going through. I said, yes, I don't understand, and I'm not trying to understand you. But what I'm trying to tell you, I'm trying to remind you of him that knows about it, even before it came. I'm trying to let you know and to bring you to understand that there is a God that is bigger than your mountains. Sometimes we seek to exalt our mountains beyond, and you know to exalt it bigger than our God. Our God is the God of the mountains and the God of the valley. So if your challenges is at the top of the mountain, there is a God available there at the top of the mountain to bring you to a place of peace. If your challenges is down there at the valley, he is still the God of the valley. Hallelujah. Let me show you something in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8 down to 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8 down to 9. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 8, then to 9. Are you there? If you're there, say amen. Amen. He said, we are troubled on some sides. We are troubled on every side. Trouble shouldn't make you as a believer to become distressed. Praise God. Give me the amplify of this. Let's amplify something a little bit here. Follow me. Give me the amplify. He said, we are pressured in every way, hedged in. Hedged in. Unsure of finding a way out. But not driven to despair. We are pressured. There is pressure in the world today. Everywhere you have family pressure, peer pressure, government pressure, economic pressure. Everything is seeking to oppress you and give you high blood pressure. Praise God. This pressure, there is a way it will come to be, and it will not be seen as high blood what? This is where it comes from. When you become so troubled. He said, we are pressured in every way, hedged in, but not crushed. Meaning that for the fact that pressure is on you, you can decide that this pressure will not crush me. You may be sick in your body. And you tell yourself and say, this sickness is not unto death. Because out of the spoken words of your mouth, you become what you say. Some are in poverty today because they are afraid of being poor. What you become afraid of becomes a master of you. But what you overcome you become a master of it. Some are afraid of death today. That's why sickness would eat their body day and night. Pastor, is it possible for me to be without infirmities? Yes, it is possible. How do you mean? The Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. If you think sickness, sickness you will see. If you think infirmities, you will see infirmities in greater measures. As a man thinketh in his heart. When you think pressure every day, you will see pressures of life. That's why the Bible says we have to guide our heart diligently, for out of it comes the issues of life. Sometimes you become unsure of tomorrow. You are not sure. Tomorrow becomes so uncertain to you. You are afraid of tomorrow. Haven't you come to terms with the word of God? He said your tomorrow is assured. Your tomorrow is protected. And the songwriter says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Not because I live, but because he lives. He said, all fears of life is gone. And because I know he owns my future. And my life is just a living. Just because he lives. Just because he lives. So therefore, I'm not standing here today because I am standing via my own abilities and strength. My strength is hidden in Christ. Christ is my strength. And another songwriter said it this way. Say, you are my strength. Strength like no other. There is a strength that friends can give to you. It could only take you for a season. There is a strength that parents could give to you. It could only take you for a season. There is a strength that your spouse can give to you. It could only go but this far. But there is a strength from God you can draw today. It's a strength like no other. It's a strength of grace. It's a strength of power. It's a strength when everywhere becomes dark. The only thing you could see is a light of God shining. Paul and Silas, they experienced that. They came to that particular place where everywhere was locked up and sealed. They did not allow the situation to rule over their consciousness, but they lifted it up to God in prayers and lifted it up to God in praises and worship. How do you know that you can make it? I know that you can make it in the time of challenges. How you praise God is what matters. Don't be that believer only when things are going well you'll be in church. Oh, no. Don't be that believer only when it is well with you, even inside the well. That is when you will come out openly and say, yes, you know, I am a faithful believer. No, you will be tried. You will be tried. Just to let you know that you will be tried. You will be tried. For every confession you have confessed as a believer, the devil will try you based on it. For every faith you say you have, there is always a challenge that wants to pull you down. You will be tried. You will be tried over things that you are not even ready for to be tried for. You will be tried. Every one of us will be tried one way or the other. What do you do when your faith start fading away? Pastor, is it possible? Yes, it is possible. What do you do when nobody believes in you anymore? How do you navigate? What do you do when you open your Bible to read and you couldn't see anything anymore? I tell you, it's real. What do you do when you try to pray but you can't pray? And the only language you understand is the language of tears. What do you do in the place of challenges? How do you navigate? Jesus was found in that particular circumstance. The Bible says he went down to Gethsemane. Let me tell you, the trials of this life is not easy. If you think it's easy, I tell you, it's not easy. And the only way for you to stay sane through that process is only in Christ, I tell you. It's only in God that you can stay strong. The Bible says on that evening, he went up to the Garden of Gethsemane. While in the garden, the Bible says he didn't just kneel, he fell down on his knees. You know what it means to fall down on your knees? You have just let it all out. And he prayed, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass away. Can I talk to us? Do you know who Jesus is? Do you know who he is? I want to believe you know. Because you don't need me to tell you who he is. He is God all by himself. He manifested himself here on earth as man and both God. Meaning every temptation and every pain you experience, how you feel, he felt it. Do you know what it means for God to cry to God? Do you know what it means for you to be told that you have 2 days to live? Do you know what it means for you to be told that the next 1 hour, the ability you have to breathe will be taken away from you? Do you know what it means? It's not because of illness, but that you have been captivated by circumstances and situation, and you have been told that in the next 45 minutes, your breath will be taken away from you. Put yourself in that shoes for once to know what Jesus was feeling at the garden. The Bible says he prayed and wept and cried to the extent that the sweat that came out of his body was as hot like a blood. Do you know who he is? He is the second in Trinity. Jesus is the manifestation of the word of God here on earth. The Bible said in the book of John chapter 1, he said, for the word, W-O-R-D, became flesh and dwelt amongst men. That tells you that Jesus is the spoken word of God that came to connect man back to divinity. Am I communicating with somebody? For the Bible says in itself the law was not perfect enough to see us through, because we cannot come to God as clean. But God looked at it and said there will be just one sacrifice that will be done, that so I can connect back to man. I can't drift enough to tell you who you are, who man is. You can go back and listen to my message, the man created by God. But I'm trying to bring you to that picture to understand that even God wept. The Bible says Jesus wept. Sometimes people come to tell you and say, stop crying. Let them let you so you let it out. Maybe sometimes you just need to let it out. Am I communicating with somebody? Sometimes you just need to pour it out. You know, there is this saying, you know, men are tough. Men don't cry. The man has not yet seen something. For when the man sees something, and something has met with something, something will tell him to cry. You know, a man will not cry when he has option. I have men in the house. Praise God. Bear me witness. Men don't cry when they have option. But when you take away their option B, C, and D, and they know when they open their wallet, there is no option. They look into their bank account, no option. They look around them, no option. Friends, no option. Family members, no option. They know that they are all alone. It will set in. and they will weep. If Jesus could weep, who do you think you are? Weeping is not a sign of weakness. That you wept is not a sign of weakness. That you wept is not a sign of you not knowing who you are. You can be the greatest prayer warrior, the greatest pastor, the greatest bishop. But a day will come when you will be tried. A day will come when you will stand all alone. You know, Jesus had people around him all this while. But when the D-Day came, the Bible says he took some of his disciples and he told them to tarry with him. They should stay here. You know, they couldn't pray with him anymore for 1 hour. A day will come as a pastor that you will feel all alone. A day will come as a sister, you will feel all alone. A day will come as a brother, you will feel all alone. A day, that day is coming when you will feel all alone. And the only person that will be with you is Jesus. The Bible says, for I will lift up my eyes up to the hills. From whence cometh my help? He said, my help cometh from the Lord, which made the heavens and the earth. Say, he will never suffer my foot to be moved. He that made me will never sleep nor slumber. It may look like he's not answering me, but hello, he's not asleep. He may look like he's not picking my calls. Hello, he's not ignoring me. He's just letting me to pass through some process of life because he wants to bring the best out of me. The best came out of Jesus after his death, not before his death. Sometimes some of us wants to be glorified, but we don't want to go through the process of being glorified. Jesus was not glorified before his death. He was actually glorified after he died, defeated death, resurrected. At this moment, the Bible said in the book of Psalms, he went to hell and said, all hail. And he gave an instruction, said, lift up your heads, all ye gates. Know who I am? I have seen it. I've come through it. I've conquered. And be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, that the King of glory. Now he's not addressing himself anymore like Jesus, the son of Joseph. No. He's now addressing himself as the King of what? Of glory. Your storm will make you the best. Your storm will bring out the greatest things in you. Your storm will bring forth great fruits inside of you. They never knew him. They never knew him. Hell never knew. Satan was rejoicing that he has finished with this prophet. But they never knew that behind the cross, there is a greatness. And he went to hell and declared, lift up your heads, O ye gates. You know what that means for the gates to be lifted up? The gates is actually the pressures of life. The gates is a storm of life. You know, every time you're knocking on the door of the gates to open unto you, it's not being lifted because you are still going through your process. But when Jesus defeated behind the scene, he was able to come out in the open. He didn't ask them. He commanded them. Be ye lifted up. He said, so that the King of glory will come in. And they asked, who is this King of glory? If you are asked, who are you? Can you defend your struggles? Can you defend your trials? Can you boldly beat your chest and tell of the story how you overcome? Come to your neighbor and say to your neighbor, say, I will overcome. Turn to somebody and say, I have overcome. Turn to some other person and say, you don't know me. Come on, turn to some other person and say, you don't know me. You don't know the stuff I am made of. and you don't know what I'm going through, turn to some other person and say, don't judge me, because you don't know what I'm dealing with. I give you two more scriptures and we move. Praise God. Let's see something in the book of Matthew chapter 14 from verse 26. Let me break something down to us. Matthew 14 verse 26. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a spirit. And they cried out for fear. Verse 27. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of what? You see that good cheer? See, let me tell you, your victory is in your confession. You remember the other scripture we raised, right? It talks about good cheer. Your victory is what? In your what? Confession. Jesus said to them, be of good cheer. What do you say when you are having storms? When people are having storms, that's why the worst people to have around you when you are having challenges are people that comes to remind you actually of the problem. They know you are having challenges and they come to remind you of point A. Oh my God. And you know, the doctor actually said that you will never be able to eat chicken again in your life. Hey, sister, are you, so how are you managing with the information that you are now having cancer? Like you told them that you are information minister. They come around you to remind you of your failures. They come around you to remind you of your brokenness. They make matters worse for you. Keep those people away from you. Not all friends are good for friendship. Hello? Not all brothers have brotherly love. And not all believers are saints indeed. Aha. You get the point now. Because your storm has different heads. There are sections of humans that you have around you that will make your storm either to be short or to be elongated. Apart from the godly activities, the God activities around your storms, how your storm would end is determined by those you surround yourself with. Every time you're having a broken engagement, and you have this friend that always, she comes only when the engagement is broken. She comes, hello, Sister D. How are you? Just how are you? she wants to say it, but you know, and you're just looking at her, well, I'm fine. Sister D, you know, I know. Don't worry, God will give you another one. You know, this was how the other ones, they left. We all know what you're going through. They will never tell you, let's hold our hands and pray. They come into your house like they want to encourage you, but they want to let you know that they know what is happening in your house. You see, don't ask me, Pastor, but how can I know them? You know them. And don't be afraid to tell them, stop coming to my house. I'm not joking. Be bold. Tell them, listen, I want you to stop coming. Because you are my problem. Because if you don't have those kind of persons in your life, you have the positive sections of them, you won't notice even when you have a storm around you, because they defend you as believers. Some wants to come because they know you are broken. They want to come and ask you questions. So because of your brokenness, you will tell them your secrets. Listen, don't tell anybody your problem that you know that the person does not have the ability to solve it. Hello? When you are going through your storm, shut your mouth. Talk more in prayers. Because 75% of the people that come around you, they want to gossip you. Praise God. They want to tell things of you around. Jesus said to them, be of good cheer. It is I. He said, be not afraid. There is one, I want to pinpoint certain things that will make your storm continue. One of it is what? Fear. When you are afraid of storms, it will keep you going through the storm. Praise God. Verse number 28. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, what? Come. Just as Jesus is saying to us today, come. And when Peter came down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. What a powerful miracle. You know, after Jesus walked on water, the second man to ever to try it was Peter. Why? Peter decided to distinguish himself from every other person. Remember, read the scripture. The Bible said they were all in the boat, but only Peter was bold enough to tell Jesus, I want to experience this thing also. Amongst all that are going through storm, be that person that wants to be different. Charge yourself to be different. Make yourself to be different. Decide that you will never end the way every other person ended. That you don't have money in your bank account is not a reason why you should give up. That you lost your job, but you still keep your life. Is no problem. And when Jesus said to him, come, this guy started stepping on water, walked on water. But let's see what happened. Verse number 30. Everybody want to go? But when he saw, what are you seeing? Distractions. You came to church and you were prophesied to that everything will be fine. You let just on the church door. Immediately you open the door to go out, you're seeing failures all around you. What seest thou? God asks Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 3. He said, Jeremiah, what seest thou? Jeremiah said, I see an almond tree. God said to him, thou hast what? Well seen. He said, this thing that you, not the one God said he saw, this thing that you, Jeremiah, have seen, I, the Lord, will hasten it and bring it to pass. So what you see with your eyes and believe in your heart is what God brings to pass. Everybody has the ability to see. Hello? If you have relationship with God, God will reveal to you about your destiny. God will show you things about things to come. And the Bible said that he was able to see. And he saw negativity. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and he beginning to sink. Each time you take your eyes, because when Jesus said to him, come, his eyes was focused on Christ. So he was moving on water. Because the eyes of the Bible said when he turned and looked at the waves of the seas, how they were looking like they want to overflow him. And but he doesn't know that as long as his eyes is kept on Christ, they can only threaten him, but nothing can come to pass. And he took his eyes off from Christ and focused on the boisterous of the sea. And immediately Christ was still with him, yet he started sinking. That is why many of us have Christ in us, but because our focus is not on God, but you love God, you go to church, you do everything, you tithe, but your focus, your eye contact is not with God. So therefore you sink because of it. And you complain and say, but I'm a believer. You can be a believer without Christ. You don't know? Okay. You know, when you ask some person, say, are you born again? They will tell you I'm baptized. Because they see baptism as you being blended into the church. No. If you are born again, you are born again. If you are not born again, be born again. I asked somebody, have you ever had an encounter with Christ? It was like I asked a question that you can only ask in outer space. And he asked me, I said, Pastor, what is the meaning of having an encounter with Christ? I'm a Christian, I'm born again. I said, oh, so you don't have an encounter with Christ. And I said to him, encounter with Christ is what you experience of Christ after you get born again. It is your own duty to step into that realm, not the duty of your pastor to pray you into that realm. That's why some of us have been born again for many years, but we are still playing around with rice on the floor. It's a taboo as a believer for many years that you could still play around with certain things, certain elements of this world are even having powers over you. You are an ego. Rejoice into your storm. You are who God has made you to be. Rise above it. It's an abomination for an ego to leave its glorious place and start dragging rice with chicken. Why not carry the rice and carry the chicken and have chicken and rice? Eat it very well. You are above it because God has made you to be above all things. Amen. He that is above all things. Amen. So you have to act it, speak it, and you start seeing it come to pass in your life. That does not mean you will not have challenges. Jesus said, in this world, meaning as long as you are alive, yeah, there will be tribulations. But that does not mean he has abandoned you. But he said, in all, you will be victorious. So which one do you want? What do you prefer? I'm not afraid of the terror by night. I'm not afraid of them. Praise God. But God has given me victory. Am I talking to somebody? One of the things you must learn to do as I round up is you must learn to call out to Christ. It doesn't matter how many times you call out, always call out. When the weight of situations becomes so much on you, cry out to him. What did Peter do? The Bible say, and he cried. Don't be afraid. Don't feel that you are less of anything when you cry out. And he cried saying, Lord, save me. Lord, save me. God is saving some of us here today. I tell you, God is saving you today. God is saving things in your life. As you begin to call on him today, from today, I see the Lord restoring back all the years that you have lost. I see God restoring back all the things that is broken in your life. I see the Lord breaking chains in the name of Jesus. I see the Lord reviving you in the name of Jesus. I see you come to fulfillment in the name of Jesus. I see the powers around you bowing in the name of Jesus. I see you break through and break forth in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and shout and hear you. verse number 31. And immediately, that's why the Bible said a broken and a contrite spirit, God will not despise. God will hear. The problem is that many of us are not broken, but we want God to hear us. So you gotta be broken for you to be amended, because God does not fix something that is not broken. God will always fix something that appears broken and it shows that it's broken. One of the things that make you are broken but you appear as unbroken is pride. When the pride of the heart is in there, some of us are even prideful to God. When God needs you to call on him, you are going before him with pride. You know, God, I'm just calling not because of I need anything from you. God, I'm just calling because pastor asked me to pray to you. So please, anything you can do, just start doing. Like you talk like God owes you or God needs you. The Bible says he is God all by himself. He doesn't need us to be God. Have that at the back of your mind. If you're happy, fine. If you're not happy, I have no apology. Praise God. But all I'm telling you today, for the fact you speak in tongues and you pray for hours, that does not make God God. He's God. Praise God. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him. And caught him. God is catching us today. And said unto him, O thou of what? Wherefore didst thou doubt? Rise up to your feet. O thou of little faith. O thou of little faith. How much? Give me Hebrews chapter 3, verse 19. Let me show us something while we stand. We're about to pray. Hebrews 3, verse 19. Let me show you something. God is great. So we see that they could not enter in because of what? Come on, because of what? They could not enter into their rest because of unbelief. You know, you could be in church, yet you don't even believe in God. You see church as a tradition in your family, but not as a relationship with God. Therefore, they could not enter. Many of us may not be able to enter because we don't really believe. But as you open up your spirit today, close your eyes and just ask God and say, Father, grant me grace to ride on my storm. Grant me grace. Help me, oh Lord, to run through troops, to limp over walls. Pray that prayer in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Let your grace, oh Lord, be upon us. For every storm of life, every challenge, oh Lord, that has come in the name of Jesus. Just pray. No, not one. There's not a friend like the Lord Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. Sing that song.
Jesus came
all about.
There is not a friend like
For you today, that may the hand that Lord Jesus is stretching out to you, may you hold that hand strong. No matter the storms of life, may they never have you. No matter the challenges of life, may they never get you. No matter the disappointments, no matter the brokenness, how much you're broken today, I pray for strength upon you. Adabo Shatagabaha Legabalado Shidabaha. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah.